the biggest news in AI right now has got nothing to do with technology. Rather, it's the sweeping policy on its fair and proper use released in draft by the European Commission earlier this week. Why am I paying attention to this? Well, it puts in place society's ethical guardrails for the third largest economic bloc on the core technology that's going to drive the fourth industrial revolution. Additionally, there's a precedent here. The Commission's digital guidelines have often become gold standards, as it was the case with the personal data protection standards 5 years ago. What the draft regulations mean is that the European parliamentarians don't actually want to see the world that John Anderton lived back in the sci-fi classic, The Minority Report. In 2016, the European Commission released draft guidelines on the protection of personal data. Called the General Protection Data Regulation, or GDPR, it was regulation focused on the protection of natural persons in regards to the processing of their personal data and the free movement of such data. Ratified in 2018, it soon became the global standard. Global companies adopted the standard, else be excluded from operating in the Eurozone, the world's third largest economic bloc. The regulatory burden of setting up and maintaining GDPR programs was massive, with programs running into hundreds of million dollars being common with large companies such as the big banks. However, the trust it brings to consumers in the capitalist system in relation to good data governance, it brings long-term system stability and arguably more than offsets the costs with access to cheaper term financing and capital from the global markets. Last week, the Commission turned its pen to AI regulation. Its broad, risk-based approach contrasts to that to what has come out so far from the two AI powerhouses, the US and China. In comparison, the US Congress is so far failing to gain consensus, working often on a case-by-case basis, leading to a complex set of precedents rather than a holistic framework. And China, where the governing philosophy puts privacy concerns of its billion citizens behind that of its desires for social stability. Let's dive into the key features of the Commission's work. The draft regulations lay down rules and procedures for placing on the market and putting into service the use of artificial intelligence systems in the European Union, those including prohibitions on certain artificial intelligence practices, specific requirements for high-risk AI systems and obligations for operators for such systems, harmonized transparency rules for AI systems intended to interact with natural persons, emotion recognition systems, biometric categorization systems, and AI systems used to generate or manipulate image, audio, or video content, and rules on market monitoring and surveillance. Although seemingly comprehensive, the rules have a number of exclusions, some of which have civil liberty activists up in arms. The military is an obvious exclusion. However, systems such as real-time biometrics can be bypassed by law enforcement and state security under certain conditions. Now let's take a closer look at what is deemed outside of society's standards. Number 1. The placing on the market or putting into service the use of an AI system that deploys subliminal techniques beyond a person's consciousness in order to materially distort a person's behavior in a manner that's likely to cause physical or psychological harm. And number 2. The use of an AI system that exploits any of the vulnerabilities of a specific group of persons due to their age, physical or mental disability, in a manner that is also likely to cause physical or psychological harm. These top two point towards the continent's aversion to any type of propaganda techniques. It respects the lived experiences that many of the countries in the continent have had to this perverse practice. Number 3. AI systems used by political authorities for the evaluation or classification of trustworthiness. Assessment of natural persons on their social behavior or personality characteristics. That is, a social score. This is in direct contrast to China's proposed social credit system, which attempts to standardize a business and citizen's economic and social trustworthiness. And number 4. The use of real-time remote biometric identification systems in publicly accessible spaces for the purpose of law enforcement. There has been a number of carved-out exceptions, such as the searching for a victim of specific crimes, including kidnapped children, specific imminent threat prevention, such as terrorist attacks, and the search for perpetrators of serious crimes, where the clear line in the sand of the seriousness is the 3-year jail time or more. This is in direct contrast to the US police usage of facial recognition technology, such as Clearview AI. The use of Clearview AI has been controversial. It has had many civil libertarian groups raising concerns of its misuse.
I think he's accessing criminal data.
Thomas King, you're under arrest.
The minimum jail time criteria also helps counter known systemic racial profiling of policing concerns for minor infringements. It's notable that military applications are exempt. It'd be thus interesting to see whether there is a mandate creep by a parliamentary decree in the future. There are also judicial overrides for most of these state constraints. There are 8 identified areas of high-risk applications that will be subject to rigorous checks and balances. Number 1. AI systems that will be used for real-time or post-remote biometric identification of natural persons. Hence, it'll be unlikely there'll be a minority report-style advertising. Also, the option of me going to my local coffee shop and having the order prepared as soon as I walk in will be unlikely. Number 2. Management and operation of critical infrastructure. Transport, water, power were explicitly identified to ensure safe, continuous supply. Number 3. Education. Any use of AI to assess students, in particular in relation to admissions. Number 4. Employment and worker management. The 2 specific areas of focus here is the selection for recruitment and promotion. Already there is too many biases in play when humans are involved. The last thing we need is those biases to be put into AI training sets and then enter the unconscious biases into a black box. Number 5. Access to services and benefits. Firstly, for the public services. Anything that helps determine accessibility and availability of a public service and benefit will need additional scrutiny. There's a specific call out on any AI system that dispatches emergency services, such as choosing the allocation of fire and emergency medical services. For private services, AI systems intended to evaluate or establish a credit score and the access to credit fall into this high-risk category. Number 6. Law enforcement agencies get the most explicit list of high-risk AI activities. The use of AI in law enforcement, in particular in relating to the overreach of authority and bias, has put particular focus on this field. The use of sentiment analysis, real-time identification systems, systems used for evidence collection, and pattern recognition in relation to crime statistics all require disclosure and additional scrutiny. Number 7. Migration, asylum, and border control. This covers a broad range of areas including application assessments by AIs for visas and asylum, authenticity checking of travel documents, sentiment analysis used to determine emotional states of natural persons, or other forms of risk assessment. And finally, number 8, justice. Any AI system used to assist the judicial authority in researching or interpreting when it comes to applying the law. I somewhat like the last one. It backs us marginally away from Asimov's three laws of robotics. And the legal system also has a well-recognized historic bias of injustices that we do not want to perpetrate in an AI training set. There's a final catch-all amendment. AI systems that pose a risk of harm to the health and safety or the risk of adverse impacts on fundamental rights. Now let's have a look at the requirements. Given this is a risk-based framework, the first step will be documenting the actual risk assessment. This is not going to be a trivial exercise. Evidence that the use of this AI is not to be embargoed or does not meet the more onerous requirements of the high-risk AI categorization will need to be gathered. For high-risk AI, there's a requirement for a formal risk management framework for each system, similar to other risk management frameworks. The components include risk identification and analysis, quantification and evaluation of the risks under an adverse usage, elimination or reduction of risks as far as possible with the appropriate design, adequate mitigation and control of risks that cannot be eliminated, notification and transparency to end users of residual risks, regular testing and oversight, appropriate data governance and cybersecurity, documentation, maintenance, and auditing of the framework. In addition to registration requirements, there will likely be public disclosure requirements as well. Conformity with the regulations will allow companies to display an accreditation logo to help promote the trust that they can freely move within the union. Finally, the big stick in the proposal. As with the GDPR, but even higher, penalties for violations are stiff. Up to 30 million euro or 6% of global revenues, whichever is higher. This will mean in today's terms, a company like Facebook could face a fine of up to 5 billion US dollars. The effect of the development of AI from this European Commission guidance is profound. It basically tells everyone the acceptable ethical standards in order to build trust with the citizenry, and what is needed by innovators in order to be future ready. The draft regulation follows a holistic risk-based approach, differentiating between the uses of AI that create unacceptable risks, high risks, or low or minimal risks. Of note, this has a number of features that contrasts the AI powerhouses of the US and China. As such, it'll be interesting to see whether the globe coalesces into universal practices, or whether multiple jurisdictional blocks will be formed.